Well, you know, I'm a big animal lover, and I think about the health of livestock sometimes. I'm not a veterinarian, but I want to introduce you to someone who is, who can tell us a little something about monitoring your livestock on your property, and that's Dr. Brent Cridell. Dr. Cridell, I would shake your hand or elbow you there. Look at that. Just say, hey, Dr. Cridell is a vet, large animal vet, and associate professor at UGA's vet school, and what a premier place to be if you're learning about large animals and the health of them. I'm aware that large animals can be deficient in particular minerals, and many of our viewers might as well and might monitor that. But when I think about monitoring a large animal, I think immediately about taking a blood sample and sending that off and having it examined. Doc, you're saying there's another way potentially to examine the internal health, and how would we do that?
Right, Nick. So in this area of the country, our soils are particularly deficient in copper. Selenium is also another challenge that we have, and it is not unusual for us to work with cattle herds that have clinical syndromes emerge that are associated with deficiencies of those. Normally, when we think of taking a diagnostic sample from a large animal, a small animal, we think about blood.
Sure.
And that certainly can be done, but one of the issues we have is that some of the mineral pools in animals, particularly in the bloodstream, are a little unstable.
Okay.
They're really subject to changes in feed intake. They are associated with changes in health status. And so those blood samples may not give us as accurate a representation as tissue samples might. And so probably the most accurate way to assess the trace mineral status of a large animal is going to be a liver sample. It seems invasive, but if you want information that you can use to help solve a problem in the herd, that's going to be the better way for us to do it. More accurate information that we can use more effectively.
And we're about to go and do this with a live animal right here on camera. And some of the ways that you might know that there is potentially a problem if I'm looking out across my herd might be what?
So most of the time when we're called to do these tests, we're doing it in a reactive fashion. A producer has identified a problem. Some of the more common problems we see would be reproductive issues. We don't have enough cows pregnant. Or maybe we have come into a herd where they've lost a lot of pregnancies. Other things that we might see would be an excessive amount of a certain type of disease. Diarrhea, pneumonia, probably the most common scenarios we'll deal with from an infectious disease standpoint. And something that we also see relatively commonly would be weak stillborn calves that presents an issue from a welfare standpoint that way.
Interesting. And before we go and do this and show everybody at home what we're about to do, how are we going to take this sample? Just how do we do this?
Yeah, so the techniques we use can look a little bit scary.
Okay.
So we're going to use a relatively long needle. This is a 15 centimeter biopsy needle that we are going to insert through the cow's rib cage into the liver and collect the sample that way.
Wow. Well, let's go and do it. Let's go into the barn. Let's take a look at this animal and let's assess and see what's going on with the situations. Come on. We're about to demonstrate what this veterinarian is going to do with this girl to sample from the liver. And I just want to preface all this by saying we're not going to cut into her today. I'm pretty squeamish myself and I might pass out on you here. We're going to demonstrate what Dr. would do, but we just want to walk it through. So, Doc, we're standing here with this girl. You've opened this window up. What's our first step if I'm your student today?
So the first step with this procedure is identifying the landmarks that we'll use for proper needle placement. So the sample that we're going to collect is going to be collected between her 10th and 11th ribs. It's going to be collected level with her hip. So what I do is I will walk back, identify the point of the hip that I'd like to use. I come across to the last rib. And cattle have 13 ribs, so I know that this last rib is rib number 13. And then I will work my way over from rib 13 to rib 12, rib 11, and then rib 10. And between those two are the landmarks that I'll use for needle placement.
Always between 10 and 11?
Always between 10 and 11.
Interesting. Okay.
Once I've identified my landmarks, the next step is to get the site prepared for sample collection. And to do that, we prepare it just as we would any surgical site. So our sample is sterile. So we'll come over, we'll collect our soap, our alcohol, into our site, scrub that. So our sample is going to be sterile and we don't predispose her to any complications such as an infection. Once that's done, so that she doesn't feel any discomfort during the course of this process, we use lidocaine to numb the site. We want everything that we do to be done humanely as possible and for her not to experience any discomfort that may jeopardize her welfare. So again, we do use lidocaine. We'll inject our lidocaine under the skin. Once we're under the skin, into the muscles of the rib as well. Once that's done, we have a scalpel blade that we'll use. And that scalpel blade is going to be used then.
Look at that. Wow.
Okay. To go through the skin and the muscle so that we don't do any damage to our needle or cause any more damage to the tissues with the needle and avoid, again, any discomfort to her.
How long after the Novocaine goes in are you able to cut?
Within about a minute.
Wow.
It doesn't take very long for that to act at all.
Okay.
Once the stab incision is made, we take our biopsy needle.
This is the big one we were talking about before. What did you say? How long was it?
So this is a 15 centimeter needle.
Wow, okay.
We take our biopsy needle, remove the outer sheath.
Mm-hmm.
We prepare it for collection. We'll go into our site. Once we're in, typically we need to go about half the depth of the needle, maybe just a little bit more to get through the skin, the muscle, and into the liver.
Mm.
Once we're in, discharge it, and our sample is collected.
Okay, so what you're looking at right now is an actual piece of a sample of a liver. And I know before I got into this segment with you today, Doc, I was envisioning like a chunk of steak coming out of a cow and that liver. We're talking about a quarter of an inch at the most, a very tiny sample. So glad to hear that. And that animal is going to recover just fine.
Correct. So the sample we take is about 10 milligrams, so relatively small. And it's somewhere between a centimeter, maybe a centimeter and a half in length. So an incredibly small sample. And that small sample allows the lab that we ship that to do a lot with it. So,
and what are they doing? What are they giving you back?
Right. So the sample goes to a diagnostic lab that is very well known for their expertise with trace minerals. And they send us back a report that covers toxic heavy metals, as well as 10 trace minerals that are commonly seen in deficiency in different areas of the country. That report comes back to us typically within 7 days.
Okay.
And once that report is back, we know normal, abnormal, and can at that point begin to make recommendations.
Okay, and we're talking about copper, selenium. Typically it's low, not too high.
Correct. So in this area of the country, we tend to see deficiencies or low levels of copper and selenium. It's rare that we find toxic levels of those in most of the animals we're working with. We are very interested in teaching students, helping them understand how they can be a resource for their clients moving forward. So they're involved every step of the way from making the recommendation that liver samples are needed to collection of the liver samples, and then once the data comes back, interpreting that data and putting together a report in conjunction with the producer, typically the extension agent, and also involving extension nutritionists, learning how to work together as a team so that they provide the best recommendations for everyone that's involved. Everybody gets the most yield.
Wow. Doc, thanks so much for joining us today.
Thank you.
Great use of extension and students' experiential learning. I hope you all enjoyed this. I sure did. You know what to do. While you're online checking out some of our previous Ranger Nick videos on YouTube and see what Ray and Kenny have got going on, hop over to the Farm Monitor Facebook page and check that out. And until next time, Brent, as we always say, I'm Ranger Nick for the Farm Monitor, reminding you that enthusiasm is contagious. So pass it on. Y'all, thanks so much for watching. We'll see you back here next month. See ya.